Hello, welcome to Online CET class. Today we will discuss the synopsis of mechanics 2 along with mechanical properties of solids and fluids. Let us proceed. So the first thing here is motion in 2 and 3 dimensions. The very first concept in motion in 2 dimensions is projectile motion. So any object that is thrown in air which moves only under the action of gravity is said to be a projectile. So for example, an object thrown from a height, an object thrown up in air, a water jet coming out from a pipe, firing of a cannon, motion of charged particle in electric field, these are examples of projectile motion. So when such an object is projected, it traces a curved path. So it's a two-dimensional curve. So that curved path traced is called trajectory. And in case of projectile, the trajectory of a projectile will be a parabola. If u is the velocity of projection and theta is the angle of projection, theta is angle of projection, it is angle made by initial velocity vector with the horizontal. Then horizontal component of velocity is u cos theta and vertical component will be u sin theta. U cos theta remains constant and vertical component of velocity keeps changing, it is subjected to gravity. So equation for the path or trajectory of a projectile is given by y is equal to tan theta x minus 1 by 2 g divided by u square cos square theta into x square. Maximum height reached by projectile is given by u square sin square theta by 2g. Horizontal range of projectile is given by u square sin 2 theta by g. Range is maximum for 45 degree. And for a given range r, there will be two angles of projection. So if one angle is theta, other angle will be 90 minus theta. So for given two complementary angles of projection, the range will be same. They reach different heights, but range will be same. Then time of flight of a projectile is given by t is equal to 2t, where small t is time taken to ascent or descent. So time of flight is time for which the projectile lives in air. So that is given by 2u sin theta by g. Time of ascent is half of that, that is u sin theta by g, and time of descent is also equal to u sin theta by g. So total time of flight will be 2u sin theta by g. Then maximum range of a projectile is for 45 degree. For 45 degree angle of projection, maximum range r will be equal to 4 times the maximum height reached at 45 degree. So when you project it at 45 degree, maximum range will be equal to 4 times the maximum height reached by the projectile. That means if this is horizontal, if you project it at 45 degree, it goes this way. So this is your maximum height and this is your range. So what this means is r is equal to 4h, or h is equal to r by 4. So that is about projectile motion. Now moving on to the next concept in two-dimensional motion, that is uniform circular motion. If an object is moving in a circular path with constant speed, then it is said to execute uniform circular motion. For example, hands of a watch, they execute uniform circular motion. So acceleration experienced by a particle in uniform circular motion is called centripetal acceleration, and centripetal acceleration is always directed towards the center of the circle. Centripetal acceleration is given by AC is equal to V square by R, where V is the speed of the particle in the circular path and R is its radius. Then centripetal force acting on the particle is given by mv square by r. So centripetal force will not increase the kinetic energy of the particle. So according to work energy theorem, work done by centripetal force is zero. Centripetal force does no work. Then if we consider motion in a vertical circle, then gravity comes into play. When a body of mass m is tied to one end of a string and rotated in a vertical circle of radius r with uniform speed v, then it is found that tension at the highest point is least. So at the highest point, tension is given by mv square by r minus mg, whereas tension is maximum at the lowest point, so that is mv square by r plus mg. So in between, tension keeps varying. So in this case, tension in the string is not a constant force. Then minimum velocity is at the highest point, that is given by root of gr. Maximum velocity is at the lowest point, that is root of 5gr. So this is about motion in a vertical circle. Then moving on to next concept, that is banking of roads. So if we consider a vehicle taking turn on the road, in order to move in a curved path, it has to have centripetal force. If centripetal force is not provided, then the vehicle will skid while taking the turn. So we have to rely on friction. So friction will provide the necessary centripetal force. But if you rely on friction, there is a problem. The vehicles will be worn out, vehicle tires will be worn out very easily. So too much dependence on friction for getting the necessary centripetal force to take the turn will not be advisable. So it is not feasible. That is why what we will do is, we will construct the road itself such that outer edge of the road is raised over the inner edge, so they are at the different level. So this process is called banking of roads, and the angle made by the tilted track of the road with the horizontal, so angle made by the plane of the road with the horizontal, is called angle of banking. And angle of banking is given by tan theta is equal to v square by rg, where v is maximum speed allowed for the vehicle, r is radius of the curved path, g is acceleration due to gravity at the place. Notice one thing, this is independent of mass of the vehicle. So mass of the vehicle doesn't matter. So that means whether it is a lorry or a bicycle or auto or car, whatever it is, so angle of banking will be same. Now that is all about 2 and 3 dimensional motion. Now moving on to the next chapter, that is work power and energy. So work is said to be done if component of an applied force F displaces a body in the direction of the component of the force. So in the direction of force, if the body gets displaced, we say work is done, and work done is given by dot product of force and displacement. Since it is a dot product, it's a scalar quantity. S unit of work is joule. Now if force and displacement are at right angles, we know that dot product gives you F dot S is Fs cos theta. So at right angles, cos theta becomes 0, so work done will be 0. So this is what is the case of centripetal force. Work done is independent of path and how much time it takes to displace. It depends on only force and displacement. When theta is less than 90 degree, angle between force and displacement is less than 90 degree, then work done is positive. If angle between force and displacement is greater than 90 degree, work done will be negative. So work done can be negative, positive, or even 0. So work done in raising a mass m through a height h vertically upwards against gravity without accelerating it is mgh. So this work done will be stored as potential energy. Now the next concept is power. Power is rate of doing work. So it is work done by time taken. So unit of power is watt. So instantaneous power is given by dw by dt. So you can write it as f into dr by dt, that is nothing but f dot v. So power can be defined as force dot velocity. So dot product of force and velocity gives you power. Then the next concept is energy. Energy is the capacity to do work. Energy is a scalar quantity. The SI unit is again joule. Both energy and work have same dimensions and same units. So if we consider the mechanical energy, mechanical energy is energy associated with a body by virtue of its motion or position or configuration. So this mechanical energy is divided into two parts. One is potential energy, other is kinetic energy. So potential energy is energy due to its position or configuration. So if we consider potential energy of a spring mass system, it is half kx square, where k is spring constant, x is displacement from its mean position. So kinetic energy of a body of mass m moving with velocity v is given by half mv square. So kinetic energy is given by p square by 2m. Then coming to work energy theorem, according to this, work done on a system will be equal to change in its kinetic energy. So final kinetic energy minus initial kinetic energy gives you work done. So work done on a body will appear as change in its kinetic energy. So this is true for variable force also, constant force also. Then coming to law of conservation of energy. So energy can neither be created nor be destroyed, but it can be changed from one form to another form. That is your law of conservation of energy. Now coming to collision. Collision is an interaction between two or more bodies in which there is sudden change in their state of motion, that is momenta, take place. So if the change in moment of the objects happens abruptly, then such a process we call it as collision. Collision need not be the two objects moving and touching each other or coming in contact always. If they exert force on each other, that is sufficient. And in some cases, like explosion of a bomb, that can also be considered as a collision. In an elastic collision, kinetic energy is equal to the final kinetic energy. Kinetic energy is conserved. Suppose if kinetic energy is not conserved, final kinetic energy is not equal to initial kinetic energy, then it is said to be inelastic collision. So to understand collision, we define a quantity called coefficient of restitution. During a head-on collision between two bodies, head-on collision means the line of motion of the particles must be same. The ratio of relative velocity after collision to the relative velocity before collision, it is called coefficient of restitution. So after collision, let us say the two particles have velocity v2 and v1. So v2 minus v1 will give you relative velocity after collision. U1 minus u2 gives you relative velocity before collision. If you just make it u2 minus u1, then you will get negative sign. So this is called coefficient of restitution. It's a dimensionless quantity. Now for a perfectly elastic collision, E will be equal to 1. Moving on to the next concept. So that is all about work energy and power. Now moving on to rotational motion and rigid body dynamics. So in rotational motion, we come across rotational variables. So first one is angular velocity. Angular velocity is given by angular displacement theta divided by t. Instantaneous angular velocity is given by d theta by dt. So it is related to linear velocity by the relation v is equal to r omega. So if the body completes n revolutions in time t, then omega is given by 2 pi n by t. So it is called angular velocity as well as angular frequency. Both are one and the same. Now coming to angular acceleration. So rate of change of angular velocity is called angular acceleration. So instantaneous value is given by d omega by dt, that is nothing but d square theta by dt square. So angular velocity is measured in radian per second. Angular acceleration is measured by radian per second square. So relation between linear and angular accelerations is a is equal to r alpha, where r is radius of the circular path. So just like we have equations of motion for linear motion, we have equations of motion for angular motion also. So first equation here is omega is equal to omega naught plus omega alpha t. This is similar to v is equal to u plus a t. Then theta is equal to omega naught t plus half a t alpha t square. So this is similar to s is equal to u t plus half a t square. And the third one is omega square is equal to omega naught square plus 2 alpha theta. This is similar to v square is equal to u square plus 2 a s. So these are equations of motion for angular motion. So the next concept here is angular momentum. So for a particle of mass m rotating in a circle of radius r and center O, about a center O, the instantaneous angular momentum L of the particle is given by L is equal to r cross p, where r is position vector of point particle with respect to point O and p is its linear momentum. So it is called moment of linear momentum. So magnitude of this is given by L is equal to mvr sin phi, where phi is angle between r and p. So unit of angular momentum is kg meter square per second. Then the next concept is moment of inertia. So moment of inertia of a rigid body about a given axis is sum of the product of masses of various particles and squares of their perpendicular distances from the axis. So if ith particle m of mass mi is at a distance ri from the axis of rotation, then mi ri square gives you moment of inertia of that particle. For whole body, it is summation of all these products from 1 to n. So SI unit of moment of inertia is kg meter square. So the name moment of inertia suggests that it is rotational inertia. It is similar to mass in linear motion. So mass is measure of inertia in linear motion. Moment of inertia is the measure of inertia in rotational motion. So in case of rotational motion, the inertia not only depends on mass, it also depends on how the mass is distributed about the axis of rotation. Next, coming to radius of gyration. So radius of gyration is denoted by k. It is distance of the point from the axis of rotation at which entire mass of the body appears to be concentrated. So that moment of inertia about the axis is mk square, where m is total mass of the body, k is radius of gyration. So it is given by k is equal to root of r1 square plus r2 square plus r3 square up to rn square divided by n. This is radius of gyration. Now for a planar body, you can calculate moment of inertia about different axes by knowing moment of inertia through center of mass. So for that we have one theorem called perpendicular axis theorem. So according to this, sum of moment of inertia along two mutually perpendicular axes in the plane of the object is equal to moment of inertia along the axis perpendicular to this plane, that is Iz is equal to Ix plus Iy. Suppose if you have a planar body, let us say it is its thickness. Now in the plane of the body, there are two axes. Let's say this is x axis, this is y axis, and through the same point I'll draw one more axis which is perpendicular to the plane. This is z axis. Then moment of inertia of the body about z axis is equal to moment of inertia about x axis plus moment of inertia about y axis. This is what perpendicular axis theorem says, and this is valid only for planar body. It is only valid for planar body, that is two dimensional object, not for a three dimensional object. Next one is parallel axis theorem. So according to this, moment of inertia of a rigid body about an axis is parallel to an axis passing through center of mass ICM of the body is equal to moment of inertia about this axis plus product of total mass m of the body and square of the perpendicular distance between parallel axes. So suppose if this is a body, it can be any rigid body, no conditions for this. Let us say this is the center of mass of the object. Through this there is a axis. Now I know that through this axis moment of inertia is ICM, so that is this. Now if I take another axis which is parallel to this, so this distance is some r, then moment of inertia about this I11 is equal to ICM plus MR square. So this is your parallel axis theorem. Using these two theorems, you can always calculate moment of inertia of different objects about the different axis. So there is a list to give moment of inertia of different shapes about different axes. So for a circular disk, through an axis passing through center and perpendicular to the plane, the moment of inertia is mr square by 2, radius of gyration is r by root 2. So to calculate radius of gyration, just take the coefficient of m, whatever is multiplied with m, that should be taken as k square, then root of that will give you k. Circular disk through diameter, it is mr square by 4, radius of gyration is r by 2. If you consider a rectangular plate, passing through, axis is passing through center and perpendicular to the plane, then it is m into l square plus b square by 12. Radius of gyration is l square plus b square by 12. For a same rectangular plate, if you change the axis, if it is passing through center and parallel to length, it is mb square by 12. So radius of gyration is b by root 12. Then if it is parallel to breadth, then it is ml square by 12. Radius of gyration is L by root 2. Same will be the moment of inertia for a square plate, where L and B are equal. Then if you have a thin rod of length L, mass M, then if the axis is through the center of mass perpendicular to its length, then moment of inertia is ML square by 12, radius of gyration is L by root 12. If the axis is passing through one of its ends, then it is ML square by 3, radius of gyration is L by root 3. So from this you can obtain this by using parallel axis theorem. Then a thin circular ring of mass m, if you have, so in the case of ring, the mass is distributed only along the circumference. So if the axis is through its center perpendicular to its plane, then moment of inertia is mr square, radius of gyration is r. For a solid cylinder of mass m, radius r and length l, moment of inertia is mr square by m into r square by 4 plus l square by 12 for an axis through its center perpendicular to its length. So about a diameter, it is for a solid sphere 2 by 5 mr square. About a tangent, it is 7 by 5 mr square. So that is all about moment of inertia for different objects. Now coming to angular momentum. Angular momentum of a particle about an axis is L is equal to r cross p, as we have seen earlier. So this is the diagram to illustrate it. So here is the mass, this is r, we have to take, this is p, r cross p we have to take. So direction of angular momentum is always perpendicular to plane formed by r and p, and the sense v is being given by right hand clasp rule. Then SI unit of angular momentum is kg meter square per second, dimensions is ml square t power minus 2. Next, moving on to torque or moment of force. So torque or moment of force about a point is the rotating effect of the force about that point. So torque is moment of inertia into angular acceleration. So torque is similar to force in linear motion. In linear motion, F is equal to ma, here F should be replaced by torque, mass should be replaced by inertia, A should be replaced by alpha. So according to law of conservation of angular momentum, there is no external torque acting on the system, then total angular momentum remains constant. Then rotational kinetic energy of a body is given by E is equal to half I omega square, where I is moment of inertia, omega is angular velocity. So angular momentum can be written as I into omega, similar to linear momentum is mass into velocity. M becomes I, V becomes omega, and P becomes L. Next is conservation of angular momentum. So as we had stated, in the absence of external torque, angular momentum of the system remains conserved, no matter what changes takes place within the system. So tau is equal to dl by dt according to Newton's second law. So if dl by dt is equal to 0, L is equal to constant, or delta L is equal to 0. So I1 omega 1 should be equal to I2 omega 2. So if moment of inertia decreases, angular velocity increases. So that is what law of conservation of momentum, angular momentum says. Now moving on to law of moments. So moment is nothing but moment of force. So it is force into perpendicular distance. The algebraic sum of moments of two or more coplanar forces about any point in their plane is equal to moment of their resultant about the same point. So this is law of moments. So it is true for coplanar, concurrent and parallel forces. So coming to parallel forces, the forces whose lines of action are parallel, they are called parallel forces. If two parallel forces are in same direction, then they are called like parallel forces. If they are in opposite direction, they are called unlike parallel forces. Then resultant of two like parallel forces, if you take P and Q, resultant will be P plus Q. If you consider unlike parallel forces, resultant of P and Q will be P minus Q. Whichever is greater, on that side it will be. So if you take moments about any point, let us say about point C here, moment due to force P is P into AC, that should be equal to Q into AC, then it will be in equilibrium. Now coming to couple, couple is a pair of equal and unlike parallel forces acting at different points on a rigid body with their lines of action not coinciding. So that constitutes a couple. So if the body is free to rotate, then it causes turning effect. So it causes pure rotational motion without any translation. So moment of couple or torque acting on the body is given by product of magnitude of one of the forces constituting the couple and perpendicular distance between the lines of action. So this line we call it as arm of the couple. So here two forces F and F, they constitute couple, equal forces. So this produces pure turning effect. So moment of couple is F into L. So coming to equilibrium of a rigid body, for translational equilibrium, the algebraic sum of the forces must be equal. For rotational equilibrium, algebraic sum of moments must be equal. That means sum of clockwise moments must be equal to sum of anticlockwise moments. So this ensures rotational equilibrium. So that is all about rotational motion. Now moving on to gravitation. So Newton's law of gravitation, this is the beginning of the chapter. It states that every particle of matter in the universe attracts every other particle with a force that is directly proportional to product of their masses and inversely proportional to square of the distance between them. So it is given by F is equal to G into M1 M2 by D square, where D is separation between the masses M1 and M2, and G is universal gravitational constant. So value of G is 6.673 into 10 power minus 11 Newton meter square per kg square. Dimensions of G are M to the power minus 1, L to L cube, T power minus 2. Force exerted by Earth on a body of mass M at a distance R from the center of Earth is given by F is equal to G M M by R square, where capital M is mass of Earth, small m is mass of the object. So if R is greater than radius of the Earth, then force decreases as R decreases. So if you consider points inside the Earth, then force decreases as R decreases, and it becomes 0 at the center of the earth. So when R is equal to 0, F is equal to 0. We'll come back to this later. Now coming to acceleration due to gravity. So we know that any object that is allowed to fall freely under the action of gravity falls with a constant acceleration. So that acceleration is called acceleration due to gravity, and it is denoted by G. So G is given by Gm by R square, or you can also write it as 4 by 3 pi R d into G, where D is density of earth, mean density of earth. So G varies with altitude and depth. So with altitude, new value of G will be equal to G dash is equal to G into R square divided by R plus H whole square. If H is the height above the earth surface, if it is very much less than R, then you can, it reduces to 1 minus 2H by R. If H is comparable to R, you have to use this equation. If it is smaller than that, then you can go for this equation. So from this, as you go above the earth surface, with increase in altitude, G value decreases. So variation of G with respect to depth, if you go inside the earth, let's say H is the depth. So at the depth D or H, it will be G dash is equal to G into 1 minus H by R. So if H is equal to R, then G dash will be equal to 0. This is what we had seen in the previous slide. So with increase in depth also, the acceleration due to gravity decreases. With increase in height also, it decreases. So it is maximum at the surface. Now moving on to motion of planets and satellites. So motion of planets and satellites can be understood by using Kepler's laws of planetary motion. So there are three laws. First one is, all planets move around the sun in elliptical orbits with sun at one of the foci. Second one is, radius vector drawn from sun to planet sweeps out equal areas in equal intervals of time. This is a consequence of conservation of angular momentum. Then the third law is called law of periods. According to the square of time period of revolution of planet is directly proportional to cube of the semi-major axis. So T square is proportional to A cube. This is third law. So these laws are applicable for any planet, any satellite, or any object moving under the action of central force. So now moving on to motion of planets and satellites. Here artificial satellites, if you consider, then orbital velocity, velocity of the satellite in its orbit, it is given by root of gm by r plus h, where m is mass of earth, r is its radius of earth, and h is height of the satellite above the earth surface. So in terms of g, you can write as gr square by r plus h. So period of satellite around the earth is given by 2 pi into r plus h divided by v naught, where v naught is orbital velocity. So it reduces to 2 pi into root of r plus h whole cube divided by gr square. See, in this step, if you square on both sides, t square is proportional to r plus h whole cube. That is your Kepler's third law. So if satellite is close to earth, then h is very much less than r, then it reduces 2 pi root of r by g. This is similar to time period of a simple pendulum of length r. R is radius of earth. Notice one thing, time period of satellite, orbital velocity, whatever you calculate, it is independent of mass of the satellite. It depends only on mass of the earth. It doesn't depend on mass of satellite. So angular velocity of satellite is given by omega is equal to root of g by r. Now coming to the energy of a satellite. A satellite of mass m orbiting around the earth has both kinetic energy and potential energy. Kinetic energy is gmm by 2r, potential energy is minus gmm by r, total energy will be minus gmm by 2r. It is similar to what we had in the case of an electron revolving around nucleus. Escape velocity of satellite is minimum, or any object for a planet, is minimum velocity that is required to leave the gravitational pull of the earth. So escape velocity is given by root of 2gr. So It is also given by root of 2gm by r. In case of earth, escape velocity is 11.2 km per second. So minimum kinetic energy with which a body must be projected to escape earth's gravity is gmm by r. So escape velocity and orbital velocity are related by the relation. This should be ve is equal to root 2 v naught. So this v naught is not inside the root. So this is the relation between escape velocity and orbital velocity. Then coming to geostationary satellite. So it is an artificial satellite revolving around the earth such that it appears stationary with respect to earth. That means its time period of revolution is equal to time period of rotation of the earth, and sense of rotation is same as that of earth. So it revolves in the same direction as that of earth. So height of a geostationary satellite can be calculated using the time period formula. Equating it to 24 hours, we'll get it to be around 36,000 kilometers from the surface of earth. So that is all about this gravitation. Now moving on to mechanical properties of solids and fluids. So first thing, with respect to solids, we have elastic stress and strain. So stress is defined as force per unit area. It is restoring force. This force is restoring force per unit area. It is expressed in Newton per meter square, or also Pascal. Strain is defined as fractional change in the dimensions of a body produced by applied force. So strain has no dimensions. It is change in dimension divided by original dimension. Then coming to Hooke's law, according to Hooke's law, within elastic limit, stress is proportional to strain. So when stress is proportional to strain, stress by strain should be constant. That constant we call it as modulus of elasticity. This is valid for small values of strain. So there are different kinds of stress and strain. Accordingly, we have different kinds of elastic moduli. So first one is Young's modulus. It is longitudinal stress divided by longitudinal strain. Bulk modulus, bulk stress divided by volumetric strain. Rigidity modulus, shearing stress by shearing strain. Then the next concept is Poisson's ratio. So according to this, within elastic limits, the ratio of lateral strain to longitudinal strain is called Poisson's ratio. When you stretch a wire, there will be increase in length at the cost of its thickness. Thickness decreases, length increases. So the ratio of lateral strain decrease in length. So if diameter is d, delta d by d divided by longitudinal strain is delta l by l. So this is called Poisson's ratio. It is denoted by sigma. Next, if you consider work done in stretching a wire, work done per unit volume. See, this is work done per unit volume of the wire is given by half into stress into strain. Otherwise, it should be half into stress into strain into volume. So this is stored as elastic potential energy in the stretched wire. Now, moving on to the mechanical properties of fluids. So first concept here is fluid thrust. So total normal force exerted by fluid at rest on any surface in contact with it is called thrust. So thrust is a force. It is measured in Newton. So pressure exerted by a fluid is given by thrust per unit area. So it is F by A. So pressure at a depth h below the free surface of a fluid at rest is given by P is equal to rho g h, where rho is density of the liquid. So atmospheric pressure is about 0.776 meter of mercury, that is 76 centimeter of mercury. So it is equal to 1.013 into 10 power 5 Newton per meter square. Newton per meter square is called Pascal. Density of mercury is 13.6 into 10 power 3 kg per meter cube. Remember, mercury is a metal, but it is liquid. So specific gravity of a substance is ratio of density of the substance to density of water at 4 degree Celsius. You know very well, density of water is maximum at 4 degrees. So when two substances A and B of mass MA and MB and densities dA and dB are mixed together, then the density of mixture is given by MA plus MB divided by MA plus MA by dA plus MB by dB. So this is one important result for solving problems. Moving on to the next concept, Pascal's law. According to Pascal's law, pressure exerted on a liquid gets distributed equally throughout the liquid. It is transmitted undiminished. So this is used in hydraulic machines like hydraulic press, hydraulic brake, hydraulic jack, hydraulic lift, etc. Then comes your Archimedes principle. According to this, when a solid body is partially or completely immersed in a liquid at rest, the liquid exerts an upward force because of which it appears to lose some weight, which is equal to the weight of the liquid displaced by the body. Weight of the liquid it displaces is equal to weight lost. That is only called buoyant force. Now moving on to fluid dynamics. So fluid dynamics deals with fluids in motion. So motion of a fluid can be classified into two categories, streamline flow and turbulent flow. So if the fluid flows such that its velocity at a point is always same both in magnitude and direction, then it is said to be streamline flow. So flow of a liquid in a tube can be considered as streamline flow. Two streamlines will never intersect. An irregular flow of a liquid in which the velocity varies with time at the same point at different times, different velocities are observed, that is called turbulent flow. So coming to equation of continuity. So when you consider a streamline flow of a ideal liquid through a pipe of varying cross section, then the product of area of cross section and velocity at that point along all the points along the pipe remains constant. That is, product of A and B is equal to constant. This is called equation of continuity. It is nothing but restatement of law of conservation of mass. Then energy possessed by a liquid in motion. It has three energies. One is potential energy, mgh, kinetic energy, half mv square, pressure energy, that is p by rho. Now coming to Bernoulli's theorem. According to Bernoulli's theorem, for a streamline flow of an incompressible non-viscous fluid, sum of potential energy, kinetic energy and pressure energy per unit mass remains constant. This is your Bernoulli's theorem. So it is used in spray pump or atomizer, Bunsen burner, venturi meter, carburetor, aeroplane wing design, and also the venturi meter, which is used to measure the flow of fluid. So that is all about fluid dynamics. Now moving on to surface tension. So force of attraction or repulsion between the molecules of a substance, they are called intramolecular forces. So there are two types of intramolecular forces. One is cohesive force, other is adhesive force. If the force is existing between the molecules of same kind, then it is cohesive force. If it is between molecules of different kind, it is adhesive force. Then we define surface tension of a liquid as the force acting per unit length on either side of an imaginary line drawn on the surface of a liquid at rest. So it is a stretching force that exists on the surface of liquid, because of which the free surface of a liquid behaves as a stretched elastic membrane. So surface tension is denoted by T. T is equal to F by L. It is expressed in Newton per meter. Then coming to surface energy, because of surface tension at the free surface, the molecules at the surface will have extra potential energy. So this extra potential energy per unit area is called surface energy. So it is numerically equal to surface tension and expressed in joule per meter square. So if T is the surface tension of a liquid and A is area of its surface, then surface energy is S is equal to T into A. If the area is equal to 1 meter square, then it is numerically equal to surface tension. So in order to increase the area from A to A dash, let us say, or A plus delta A, you have to do some work. That extra work done will be stored as surface energy. Coming to next concept, that is angle of contact. Angle between tangent to the liquid surface drawn at the point of contact and the solid surface inside the liquid is called angle of contact. So it is constant for given pair of solid and liquid. It is denoted by theta. So for a liquid which wets the surface, theta is acute. If the liquid does not wet the surface, then theta is obtuse. Now moving on to next concept, capillarity. The phenomena of rise or fall of liquid in a capillary tube immersed partially in the liquid is known as capillarity. When glass capillary is dipped in water, the water rises in the tube above that of the level in the container in which it is dipped. So if it is dipped in mercury, there will be depression created. Level of mercury in the tube will be less than the level in the trough. The height to which the liquid rises in the capillary tube is called capillary rise. It is given by 2t cos theta divided by rho r g, where t is surface tension, r is radius of capillary tube, rho is density of liquid taken, g is acceleration due to gravity, and theta is angle of contact. Here, one thing you should notice, if the length of capillary tube is less than h, then angle of contact changes and there will be no overflow of liquid. Now coming to excess pressure. So inside a liquid drop, excess pressure is given by P is equal to 2 sigma by R. Inside a soap bubble, 4 sigma by R. Inside a air bubble inside water, it is 2T by R, where sigma is surface tension. T is also surface tension, sigma is also surface tension. In some references, you will find sigma for surface tension, in some references T, and in your NCERT, it is given S. So next concept is viscosity. So viscosity is fluid friction. So it is a property by virtue of which one layer of liquid opposes the motion of other layer on it. So it's an internal friction. So this internal tangential force tends to destroy the or delay the relative motion between the various layers. So this force we call it as viscous force or viscous drag. So it is given by F is equal to eta A dv by dx. Negative sign states says that force is opposite to direction of velocity, where A is area of the layers, dv by dx is called velocity gradient, and eta is called coefficient of viscosity. So if A is equal to 1 and dv by dx is equal to 1, then F is equal to eta. So coefficient of viscosity of a liquid is defined as tangential force per unit area required to maintain unit velocity gradient for unit area. So SI unit of viscosity is decapoise. So it is equal to 1 newton second per meter square. So CJ's unit of eta is poise. So 1 decapoise is equal to 10 poise. 10 poise is equal to 1 SI unit. So 1 SI unit is 10 CJ's units. So viscosity depends on temperature. So for a liquid, viscosity decreases with temperature. For gas, viscosity increases with temperature. Now coming to Stokes' formula. So viscous force acting on a spherical object falling through a viscous medium. It is given by F is equal to 6 pi eta r v, where r is radius of the sphere and v is the velocity. As it falls, its velocity goes on increasing, so viscous force also goes on increasing. So this relation is called Stokes' law or Stokes' formula. Now, when the body is allowed to fall in a viscous fluid, its apparent weight of liquid becomes equal to a viscous force when it reaches the velocity called terminal velocity. As it falls, its velocity goes on increasing, so viscous force goes on increasing, but weight remains constant. So upward force goes on increasing, downward force remains same. So at a point, they come to equilibrium. In addition to that, there will be buoyancy in the upward direction. So when balance is achieved, acceleration stops, it reaches constant velocity. That velocity we call it as terminal velocity. So it is given by 6 pi eta rv is equal to 4 by 3 pi r cube rho minus sigma into g, where sigma is density of medium and rho is density of object. Then eta is given by 2 r square rho minus sigma into g divided by 9 v. If you want to calculate terminal velocity, just cross multiply this to here and send this back to here. Then comes the concept of Reynolds number. So according to Bernoulli's theorem, more is the speed of fluid layers, less is the pressure, and less is the speed, more is the pressure. So the flow of liquid is classified into laminar flow and turbulent flow. Laminar flow is nothing but streamline flow. So at what speed the laminar flow of liquid changes into turbulent flow? So that speed is called critical speed of the liquid. So Reynolds number gives the relation between the critical speed density, viscosity, and the diameter of the pipe through which the liquid is flowing. So Reynolds number is given by Vc rho d divided by h, where h is coefficient of viscosity. So let us change it to eta only. So eta is viscosity here also. So it's a ratio of inertial force to the viscous force. So critical velocity can be given by Reynolds number into eta divided by rho into d. It is this Reynolds number which is a dimensionless number. I told you it is ratio of two forces, so it's a dimensionless number that decides whether the given flow is turbulent or streamline. If Reynolds number lies between 1000 and 2000, so liquid flow switches between laminar to turbulent. If Reynolds number is greater than 2000, then it is turbulent flow. It is less than 2000, it's a laminar flow. So this is about your Reynolds number. So that completes the mechanical properties of solids, fluids, and mechanics too. Thank you.